Hi, I'm Rowan from Vantage Admissions, and in this video, we're going to work through a recent Cambridge Maths interview question. This question is on integration and uses a very important and interesting technique, which we see reported more and more frequently as the years go on. If you're interested in more interview questions or broader support with your interview preparation, do remember to subscribe and to visit our website. So in this question, we're asked to consider an integral. Now, aside from the fact the integral itself looks quite complicated, there's also the weird fact that it depends on a parameter z. So even though the integration variable is x, it's an integral dx, I've got this other variable z that features in the integrand. And so even after I'm finished integrating and I've replaced x with the limit in the antiderivative, we're expecting to get a function of z left over, not just a number. Now, I'd recommend at this point, you might like to pause the video and have a go yourself before you continue. And for those of you still watching or having unpaused, let's now jump in. So people often say with interview questions, you should think out loud. And I think a big part of what that means, at least at first, is actually identifying what it is that makes the question look difficult. There's a big difference between being completely stumped at a question and not being able to even comment on what makes it challenging, versus at least being able to identify what is unusual, what is intimidating about the problem. So we can start by noting that it is pretty weird that the integrand, the function that is being integrated, depends on a parameter z. And I guess we should consider this to be a continuous parameter because we're not told it's an integer or anything. So that's strange. And if there's something weird, something unusual, something striking, most of the time we're going to use that strange thing to our advantage. So we need to think about how we can utilize the presence of a parameter z. And I guess the other thing is, why is this a challenging integral at all? Well, if it was just an e to the minus x, or an e to the minus zx, exponentials are really easy to integrate. So the thing that makes this a slightly nasty integral is the presence of an over x. That x on the denominator completely spoils our ability to just integrate this thing by inspection. So we've identified what makes the integral challenging. We therefore know where to target our efforts. And we've also identified what is special, what is unusual. Okay, so how can we make some progress on this integral? Well, there's not really an obvious substitution. I could substitute an exponential, for example, but if I do that, the x on the denominator is going to become a log, and having a log x on the denominator is probably even worse than having an x. Likewise, it doesn't seem especially as if integration by parts is going to help, because if I let one of the factors be 1 over x, I think it's fair to say it gets worse if we integrate it or differentiate it. It will become a minus 1 over x squared if we differentiate it, or it will become a log x if we integrate it. So integration by parts seems to only lead to worse things. And therefore, we should really try to focus our fire on what we can do with this z. It must be there for a reason. It must be that there's something we can do with this z to help. So here's a slightly crazy idea that if you've seen before might come to you quite naturally, but is a little bit of a creative leap if you haven't. What if we took a derivative with respect to z? So this idea of taking a derivative of an integral with respect to some parameter, in this case z, is sometimes called Feynman's trick, after the physicist Richard Feynman, who popularized it. And it's a trick that more and more interview questions each year seem to need. So what's the motivation for doing this? Well, if I do take a derivative with respect to z, the derivative can simply pass through the integral, because the integral is an integral with respect to x. So it's like a sort of continuous kind of limity type sum over x. It's got nothing to do with z, so z can just happily pass through. And when I differentiate the integrand with respect to z, nice things happen. I mean, this term is actually just zero because it has no z, it only depends on x. And when I differentiate this piece, I'm going to pick up a multiple of minus x by the chain rule when I differentiate that. And it will kill off this denominator x, which is precisely the term we identified as challenging. Now, that's not going to be the end of the story, even though it seems we might be able to work out di by dz, because the differentiation will make the integral easier. We still need to think about how we'll actually go about finding I itself, but that will presumably just require us to take another integral with respect to z. So if we take the derivative, we can see that dI by dz, so I'm going to pass the derivative through the integral. This term differentiates to nothing because it has no z dependence. And for this term, well, the derivative, I mean, the minus and the 1 over x, those are both just constants as far as z is concerned. And the derivative of e to the minus zx by the chain rule, remember we're doing a z derivative, is minus x e to the minus zx. So the difficulty here is we're so used to x being the variable we're differentiating with respect to, it feels slightly strange that x is now being treated as a constant. So this is also a nice way for them to test our flexibility of thought when we're dealing with derivatives. So as promised, this makes the integral much easier. The minus 1 over x and the minus x simply cancel, and I'm left with what is now a pretty trivial integral, e to the minus zx dx. I can integrate that very easily using the reverse chain rule, if you like. So I divide by the derivative of minus zx, which is just minus z. So remember that now I'm integrating with respect to x, not z. So I'm having to be really fluent and flexible jumping between the variables. Now, at the infinity limit, clearly whether that blows up or decays to zero depends a bit on z. We were told in the question that z is positive. So because z is positive, the infinity limit, well, that's going to decay to zero. I've got a very large negative exponent. So the infinity limit contributes nothing. And the zero limit, well, e to the zero is one. So I just get zero minus minus one over z, which is one over z. So this is excellent progress. By taking the derivative, we've managed to get a really easy integral and compute dI by dz. Now, if I want to learn about what I is, all I need to do is take an integral of this with respect to z to undo that original derivative. So the beauty of this approach is we trade one integral, which we couldn't do, with two integrals. We did the x integral, now we do the z integral, but they're both easy enough. So I of z is therefore the integral 1 over z dz. That would normally be ln of modulus z, but I'm going to drop the modulus because we know that z is positive. And we have to remember our integration constant plus c. So we're almost done, but we can't leave this plus c in our answer. There must be some way to pin down the value of c. Okay, well, how do we normally pin down an arbitrary constant after taking an indefinite integral? We have some boundary value, some initial value. We're meant to know what the function is for some simple input, and we feed that in to eliminate c, to find a value for c. So looking at my integral, is there any choice of z for which the integral is easy or trivial? Because if there is an easy version of the integral for some z, I can figure out what I is meant to be for a particular value. Well, clearly if z is 1, I get something very simple, because then these two terms cancel out and I've just got the integral of 0. So we can see very easily that I of 1 is simply 0, because I have an integral of 0, the numerator cancels, and now I can feed that in to help me find c. So I of 1 is 0. That tells me that 0 is ln of 1 plus c, but ln of 1 is 0, so we get that c is 0. And that means overall, we've got just that I of z is very simply ln of z. So this is often the case when you write these integrals which depend on a parameter, they secretly will correspond to a really quite simple function. So this idea, Feynman's trick of using differentiation with respect to a parameter to simplify the integral, is a very powerful idea. In very extreme cases, you could imagine having to choose to introduce a parameter for yourself in order to simplify an integral. But in most cases that we see reported from interviews like this question, the family of integrals with dependence on a continuous parameter will be handed to you. And remember, the real giveaway that the differentiation was going to be helpful was the fact that it would let us cancel a very unwelcome denominator factor. So identifying what it is that makes the integral challenging is really helpful in letting us see where to direct our efforts. I hope you found this question interesting. Comment below to let us know what you'd like to see next. And if you want to see more interview questions and advice on interview preparation, do remember to subscribe. If you're interested in more intensive support with your interview preparation, do also remember to visit our website. And thank you very much for watching.